My name is Larry Levy. I'm the Executive Dean of the National Center for Suburban Studies at Hofstra University. Thanks. And I believe, I know that diversity is the key to our social and economic success. In these vibrant young voices, in the multicultural artistry you've been enjoying all night, you can feel what this seventh annual celebration of suburban diversity is all about. Now, we aren't where we need to be. We know that racial segregation, immigrant bashing, and other forms of discrimination still plague us. We know that sometimes hate can kill. But we can dream. We can dream in the spirit of Dr. King that one day the majority of Long Island's minority students will no longer be segregated, isolated, packed into our poorest schools. We can dream that 68 years after Levittown officially discriminated against people of color, that no family should have to worry about racial steering and redlining and not being able to live in the neighborhood where they want. We can dream that one day we all will celebrate our growing diversity as our greatest strength, that all lives will matter equally. That's what this event is about, dreaming and doing. The celebration was conceived to bring people together, and we've certainly done that, well over 600 people strong. It's also a fundraiser that has supported grants for researchers, scholarships and internships for students, and support for our community partners, all dedicated to diversity-related endeavors. And this year, I can't thank you enough. We have again crushed, and I mean crushed, previous records for attendance and donations. So please give yourselves a hand. You deserve it. There's no room like this on Long Island or anywhere else I know. Now, I want to thank honoree Scott Reckler for stepping up as keynote speaker and working really, really hard to make this event a success. You'll also be hearing from honorees Sandy Brewster Walker, our first Native American honoree, and Gemma DeLeon Lopresti, and Raj Mehta, and Mandel Smith. Let's hear it for all our honorees. They honor us by letting us honor them, just as you all honor us by being here tonight. Now, I'd be more than remiss if I didn't thank George Tunis, last year's inspiring keynote speaker, who served as this year's dinner chair. Thank you, George, for your work this year. I'd like to thank Senior Assistant Dean Ina Katz, who almost single-handedly organized this dinner to the smallest detail. She makes my life very easy. I'd also like to thank Feldis Florists for the table arrangements, and of course, the great staff of the Crest Hollow Country Club. And since this is Veterans Day, please indulge me in MC's prerogative. And let me thank my son, David, who served in Iraq in the 10th Mountain Division, one of the last soldiers in Iraq. Thank you, David, and all who served with you, before you, after you, everywhere and through all time. Thank you to our veterans. This has been another busy year for Hofstra's National Center for Suburban Studies. Under the academic leadership of Dr. Chris Neat, he's here somewhere, yeah, whose recent works, published by Temple and Stanford University Presses, are must-reads if you care about the suburbs, we are partnering, presenting, and publishing with scholars around the world. Under Dr. Bob Brinkman, who I think is back there with Chris, who will soon be see the publication of the Sustainability Studies textbook in this country. Our sustainability research and degree-granting program has become a magnet for students and businesses alike. Now, in the past, and this is kind of the bragging portion of my program, mini program here. In the past, I've told you about the center's help in planning two bipartisan White House summits on the suburbs. I've told you about our national suburban poll, which has been an indispensable tool to academics, journalists, and political professionals. I've also told you how Bob traveled to China to form a research partnership on environmental stewardship, and how both Chris and I presented at a conference in England, held as part of an international network that he helped create. Yes, we're proud of our name-droppy partnerships and international footprint, but know this. Nothing is more important to us at the National Center for Suburban Studies than what we do on and for Long Island. The NCSS has collected oral histories of elderly African Americans who endured the slings and arrows of early suburbanization, and now they're featured in a major exhibit on Black suburbia at the Schomburg Center, the nation's leading research institute on Black culture. In partnership with Hofstra's Masters of Public Health program, Dr. Martine Hackett, who's also in the room, I saw her earlier, has led the creation of our new Suburban Health Equity Institute and its initial initiatives on childhood obesity in Roosevelt and the intersection of health and housing in Hempstead. We helped produce the post-Sandy recovery plans for Suffolk's hardest hit communities. We've partnered with Harvard University's Graduate School of Design to reimagine storm-ravaged neighborhoods throughout Long Island. We've assisted Nassau County with its transportation planning at the hub and North Hempstead with the town's cutting-edge program for the elderly. We've conducted market analyses for financial institutions and community outreach for engineering firms and developers from as far away as Pasadena and London. Our research and writing has helped the Long Island Regional Economic Development Council win upwards of $300 million for our region, including funds to rebuild Wyandanch, Huntington Station, and other hard-pressed places. The common themes of all our work, diversity and its companion in sustainability, they're not only what we do, they're who we are, and tonight, they're what we celebrate. So now it's my privilege to introduce the person who first conceived of the National Center for Suburban Studies, a visionary not only for Hofstra, but well beyond, through his leadership of the Regional Economic Development Council and in other critical areas of civic life. Please welcome Hofstra President Stuart Rabinowitz.
Thank you very much. I am one of the, as the other honorees are, I'm one of those who received a note from Larry Levy saying, you may not speak for more than 2.5 minutes. Well, Larry took up everybody's 2.5 minutes. I did conceive of the National Center on Suburban Studies. I did not conceive of Larry Levy. That came second. And, you know, we all love Larry, but it's a little dangerous to compliment Larry too often. But the job that he and Chris and Bob have done with the National Center for Suburban Studies sort of summarizes my presidency. I come up with some strange idea, and then I hire fabulous people who go way beyond anything I imagined. And the National Center, you know, has done exactly that. And I couldn't be prouder of them. And I couldn't be prouder of tonight. This is such a wonderful occasion for all of Long Island and Hofstra University. And I have to, in a way, second what the musical director said about his choir. I mean, to look at those young people and listen to them and see them stand together is so inspiring about what Long Island's future will be. And anybody or any region who doesn't get the fact that diversity will strengthen you is not only gonna be left behind, they will disappear. They will disappear in this country. So this to me is an inspiration to continue what we're doing. It's also a way simply for all of us who are here in the university to, once again, we don't have to do this, but we should. Once again, Let us all embrace diversity as a fundamental human value. And let us all commit to promote understanding and acceptance between and among people of different cultures and different backgrounds. Nothing else makes sense. Nothing else is moral. Tonight is also a celebration of what Hofstra tries to do in terms of teaching its students every day. Every day, our faculty tries to teach our students to approach what is unfamiliar with open hearts, not closed hearts, with open minds, not closed minds, to be curious and to be compassionate, and to see our shared humanity in others first and appreciate our individual differences second. As an academic institution, Hofstra believes it is our responsibility to create a safe and a nurturing environment in which to explore diversity. And we try to encourage that exploration in every aspect of campus life. That is, for us, both a scholarly endeavor and a political and a social and a moral imperative. So this is a great night for Hofstra. Now, I am here for a very special reason and for a very special privilege, which is to introduce our keynote speaker, Scott Reckler. I have to begin by telling you that in one way, Scott has disappointed me. I have been chasing him for 15 years to be on our Board of Trustees. We got him on the Honors College Advisory Board, but we haven't got him on our Board of Trustees yet. I am sure at the close of his remarks tonight, he will say how happy he will be to join the Hofstra Board of Trustees. Sorry. I hate to put you on a spot, but it's important. Anyway, Scott is well known to all of us. He's a regional leader. He's a national leader. He's known to us as a philanthropist, a developer who creates economic opportunity while reimagining, not repeating, but reimagining our landscape. As chairman and CEO of RXR, Scott oversees a multi-billion dollar private real estate company, which was formed back in 2007. Since its formation, Scott has led RXR in becoming one of New York's tri-state area's leading real estate company. He actually has an astounding $9.3 billion worth of assets under management, which is comprised of 91 properties encompassing 20 million square feet. And that's big, 20 million. Above all else, I think what Scott really prides himself on, based on our conversations, is that he's not just a real estate developer, but he insists on trying to enhance the communities where RXR operates. So he serves on numerous boards, not yet Hofstra, but numerous boards. So he is a member of the Honors College, the Hofstra Honors College Advisory Committee, the Real Estate Board of New York, the NYU, it's okay, he has a degree from the NYU Real Estate Institute Advisory Committee. Scott also serves as co-chair of the Board of Trustees for Friends Academy, which is a great private school out here, as you know. And he serves on the board of many other of the region's top cultural institutions, such as the Long Island Children's Museum and the Tribeca Film Institute. Scott has been very active in matters that are important to our region, and he has provided much needed and sage counsel on complicated issues of public policy. In June 2011, Scott was appointed by New York Governor Andrew Cuomo to serve on the Board of Commissioners of the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey. And now he serves as the Port Authority's vice chairperson. He also serves as the chairman of the Port Authority's Capital Planning Committee, where he oversees the port's $30 billion capital budget, including that for the World Trade Center development. And in May of 2013, Scott was appointed to represent the governor on the board of the National September 11th Memorial Museum and World Trade Center Foundation. Scott is also active in the real estate profession with the Real Estate Roundtable and as a member of the Political Action Committee of the Real Estate Roundtable. He's a graduate of Clark University, and he earned a Master of Science degree in real estate at the New York Institute NYU Shack Institute. Please join me tonight in welcoming our keynote speaker and honoree, whose leadership and generosity and counsel has helped countless Long Island and New York institutions, Scott Reckler.
Thank you, Stuart. With friends like you, you know, I think after reading all the different boards I'm on, you would understand why right now I can't join Hofstra's board. But I am an enormous fan of Hofstra, so I promise you, one day, I will join Hofstra's board. And I'm also a gigantic fan of Stuart Rabinowitz. As a long-term Long Islander, I know how much Stuart's leadership has meant to the entire region. Literally, from my office's window, I've watched Hofstra grow into a powerhouse that promotes education, economic development, and diversity far beyond its campus footprint. There never seems to be a project too bold for Stuart, including this institute here. Stuart, Long Island, and frankly our region would not be where they are today without you and your vision, so thank you for all that you do. I'd also like to thank Larry Levy, who organized this dinner and who worked tirelessly to ensure tonight's great success. Larry's extraordinary energy and passion has enabled him to build the National Center for Suburban Studies into an incredible institution for Hofstra, as Stuart noted, but also for the region and the country at whole. I grew up reading Larry's columns in Newsday. I hope that doesn't make you feel too old, Larry. I apologize about that. And I now consider him a trusted friend and advisor on everything from politics to development projects. Larry, I can't tell you how much I appreciate you always being there for me personally and all that you do for Long Island. Thank you, my friend. And of course, I can't not thank my friend George Tunis for chairing tonight and helping make tonight such a great success. And George pushing me to make my remarks a little bit more personal, which I'm a little less comfortable with, so that I can share some additional insights tonight. So thank you, George, for all that you've done for Hofstra and for me. It's apropos that this event is occurring on Veterans Day, because freedom, equality, and diversity are at the heart of our country's values, values that our servicemen and women have defended time and time again. I want to take a moment to thank all of those who have risked their lives and sacrificed to defend our country and these values, including Larry's son, David, who I believe is here tonight, right? Is David here tonight? So thank you all for all that you do for our country. Where is David? David, stand up. Oh, his brother's here. Okay. You lied to me, Larry. Okay, too old. There you go. So, and diversity has always been an important part of my life, going the way back to Hebrew school. I wasn't a very good student in Hebrew school, but then again, who is a good student in Hebrew school? But I did absorb a few important things. And one was that we are all created in God's image, which I always understood to mean that we are all equal in dignity and ultimate worth, no matter our color, culture, or creed. This is a lesson that was taught to me in so many other ways. When I was growing up in Port Washington, my classmates were from all walks of life, and my parents always maintained a diverse group of friends. As a result, I was lucky enough to grow up surrounded by people of different religions, races, socioeconomic backgrounds, and sexual preferences. Being around a diverse group of people has always been comforting to me. It has always been what's normal to me. The same was true for my wife, Debbie, who grew up in Northern Arizona. There's Debbie over there. Stand up on you, you're too short to be able to see it in that mix there. My father-in-law, who was a Jewish doctor born and raised in Philadelphia, chose to move his young family to faraway Flagstaff, an idea that did not go over too well with his mother-in-law at the time. At the time, Flagstaff was a diverse community largely made up of Native Americans and clearly no Philly cheesesteaks for my father-in-law or his father-in-law. When our children, Gabrielle and Elijah, were getting ready to start school, Debbie and I chose Friends Academy primarily because it is grounded in Quaker principles that include embracing diversity. As a matter of fact, the Quaker mission of Friends, which dates back to the 1600s, notes, and I quote, that diversity is an integral part of our lives, and excellence means valuing and appreciating inclusion. And the school has practiced what it preaches. As a result of a lot of hard work by so many people, some of which are here tonight, over the last 5 years, the school has increased its diversity from 16% of the student body to 34%, with a special focus on Black and Latino students. Friends Academy is a special place that does special things. Thanks to their own exposure to diversity, our kids, from a very young age, embrace the experience of being surrounded by people of different backgrounds. At age 8, our son Elijah joined Glencoe football. Soon afterwards, our lives were forever changed when a small, yet inarguably brilliant and talented young boy of color embraced our son and captured all of our hearts. 10 years ago, Tyrone joined our family in our home and had a successful career at Friends Academy. We are now the proud family of a Syracuse University D1 football player. Gabrielle, Elijah, and Tyrone made sure that our house became a magnet for children from all walks of life. These children not only felt comfortable in our home, but were also appreciated for the diverse perspectives that they brought to our lives. At times, our house felt as diverse as the UN, but without the squabbling, of course, sometimes. It was an environment that we all cherished. As a matter of fact, when Elijah filled out his preference sheet for his freshman roommate at Cornell, his one request was that it had to be someone of color. Having Tyrone and all of these wonderful children in our lives have been a real blessing. All of us have learned the true enrichment that comes with being around people who are different from ourselves. But understanding different perspectives and cultures has more than personal value. It has also become critical to achieving success in today's globally integrated world. I saw this just last week when I spent several days traveling to cities in China, meeting with potential investors for RXR. I had the opportunity to hear what a wide range of Chinese investors, government officials, and business people thought about our area. At a time when so many in the United States believe our country is in decline, the Chinese people I spoke with were excited about our region. They saw in New York a city of promise and opportunity, a city that is welcoming to all, no matter where you are from. Frankly, like so many other people from around the world, many of them would love the opportunity to actually live, work, or come visit our great city of New York. And a host of statistics validate their assessment of New York. Population at an all-time high. Employment at an all-time high. Visitorship at an all-time high. So why is New York doing so well? And by the way, why am I telling you this at a dinner celebrating suburban diversity? Let me try to get to that. It's my opinion that the biggest reason why the city is thriving is the incredible diversity of its population. There is no other city in the world where diversity is so embedded in its DNA. And that's the magic of New York. Today, 37% of New York City residents were born in another country, reaching a new record. To put this in context, the city of New York now has a foreign-born population that is larger than the entire population of Chicago. This diversity creates a richer quality of life, and that attracts more people from around the world, which in turn makes New York even more attractive. It's a virtuous cycle of prosperity. In such a globally integrated environment, the world is smaller than ever, and your customer, partner, or friend can just as easily be from around the globe as from around the corner. Thus, connections to and understanding of different cultures, preferences, and markets are increasingly a key to success. New York City also benefits from economic diversity. New York is a global magnet for the well-educated, the creative, the entrepreneurial, and not just in one industry, but across a range of industries, from finance to fashion, from media to healthcare. If businesses want to find the best and brightest, the most innovative, the odds are they will find them in New York. New York is a city where people from all walks of life come to make their dreams a reality. But the flip side of all of this success is that today, New York is being overwhelmed by the many people who want to be here. All this demand has resulted in a shortage of reasonably priced housing in which people can live, and reasonably priced places in which businesses can operate. Costs across New York continue to soar, and that's not sustainable, not for our people, not for our economy. Well, this is where our increasingly diverse and underappreciated suburbs enter this story. Thanks for sticking through the rest of that part of the story. Once again, they have the potential to provide a critical relief valve for all of this demand-driven pressure in the city, a kind of back-to-the-future moment for the region. After all, for much of the post-World War II era, the story of the New York region was a story of a thriving periphery and a rotting core, as the city bled jobs and population, and the suburbs expanded and prospered. However, by the turn of the millennium, the story reversed itself. In fact, between 1996 and 2014, employment in New York City grew at twice the rate as the suburbs. Twice the rate as the suburbs. But why? What changed? Part of it is that for many people, the traditional suburban model simply lost its luster. Increasingly today, people, especially young people, are not interested in the cookie-cutter, car-dependent suburbia of the past. Increasingly today, people want to live, work, and play in places that are not antiseptic, but have character, texture, and history. And increasingly, people want to live, work, and play in places that are more diverse. This has created a mismatch between what people in our suburbs want and what they're able to find. But there's good news for the suburbs. We have communities that are not only have the diversity that people crave, but are also walkable and have genuine character and are easily accessible to New York City via public transit. These are the suburban downtowns that historically were the hearts of our towns and villages. Unfortunately, over time, many of these downtowns have fallen on hard times, with people moving out of their residential buildings, shoppers fleeing to malls, workers fleeing to office parks, and buildings being torn down to make way for commuter parking. Today, though, these areas provide us with a golden opportunity, for they have all the ingredients that the modern workforce is looking for. Instead of insidious white flight, now we can create what you might call right flight, or the revival of areas where people of different backgrounds can come together to build new, successful communities. And it couldn't come at a more critical time, especially for hard-placed areas that have suffered from disinvestment. To allow these suburban centers to reach their potential, we need to re-energize them. We need to invest in their aging infrastructure. We need to create new housing and amenities that meet the demands of the 20th century workforce. We need to ensure that they are safe. We need to make sure that their public education systems function again. And most of all, we need to bring back economic opportunity to them. And we must do all of this in a way that doesn't gentrify or homogenize these places, but instead nurtures and builds on their wonderful diversity. At RXR, we're working closely with local communities and governments and government groups in downtowns throughout our region to do just this. From Stamford in Connecticut to New Rochelle and Yonkers in Westchester to Glen Cove, Huntington Station, and Hempstead here on Long Island. We're hoping to help them reimagine their downtowns in a way that enhances the quality of life for those now living there and to position these places as attractive alternatives to an increasingly expensive New York City. And at the same time, make these areas so special, embracing what makes these areas so special, their diverse cultures and character. Diversity not only makes for richer communities, both socially and economically, but is also good for business because it attracts the workforce that companies know they need to succeed. To put it simply, we believe if we build it, they will come. In the process, helping both to revitalize our historic downtowns and to create broader economic vitality and cultural vibrancy that will re-energize suburbia for the 21st century. Before concluding, let me reflect on one other thing I learned when nobody thought I was paying attention at Hebrew school. Namely, the concept of Takan Olam. That's the responsibility of each and every one of us to literally repair the world, to do our part to make our world, to make our communities better places. Today, we have a unique opportunity to capitalize on our regional momentum to repair our challenged suburban downtowns that have been broken for too long. Today, we have an opportunity to reverse the vicious cycle of decline that has depressed neighborhoods and destroyed dreams. Today, we have an opportunity to rekindle hope by creating educational and career paths that have been denied to generations. Today, we have an obligation to grab these opportunities and make them a reality. In my own life, it has given me enormous happiness to see all of my kids, not just Gabrielle and Elijah, but Tyrone too, flourish in a supportive home, in a safe neighborhood, and in a superb school. But in a place as affluent as Long Island, I think every child should enjoy the same sense of security in their own neighborhoods. Every child should have access to the best teachers and technology. Every child should be able to dream and have a fair chance to realize those dreams. It won't be easy, but today, at this particular moment in our history, we have a chance to change the arc of our story, to repair our world one suburban downtown at a time. We can't afford to waste this chance. After all, isn't that why we're all here tonight? Thank you very much, and thank you for this great honor.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm Chris Neat. I'm Academic Director at the National Center for Suburban Studies at Hofstra.
And I'm Bob Brinkman, the Director of Sustainability Studies at Hofstra. And we're pleased today to present the winners of the highly competitive High School Suburban Diversity Essay Contest. And once again, the contest is sponsored by the Bethpage Federal Credit Union, which is represented tonight by Senior Vice President Linda Armin. Linda is a great friend of Hofstra and many of your organizations. So thank you, Linda, especially for Beth Page's commitment to underserved communities.
And now for the winners. First prize of $3,000 goes to Kian Liu, a senior at Garden City High School. Kian, please step forward. Kian's insightful and well-written essay is reprinted in the program. If she chooses to attend Hofstra, and we hope she does, we will double the award to $6,000. Congratulations to Kian and her family and to her teachers.
Second prize goes to Daniel Cubis, a senior at Eastern Long Island, BOCES Long Island Academy of Applied Technology. Daniel, please come forward. And Daniel will receive $1,500 or $3,000 if he attends Hofstra. So congratulations to Daniel and his family.
Third prize goes to Ariana Felician, a senior at Bayshore High School. Ariana will receive $1,000 towards her college costs, and again, it's an amount that will double if she brings her talents to Hofstra.
I want to mention that every one of the districts that entered a student in the contest will receive $150 for a diversity initiative. I'd also like to point out that over the years, the schools of two of our winners, Garden City and Bayshore, have been in a class by themselves in consistently producing great essays. Well done to those schools. Thank you.
Good evening. Larry and I had made a deal from the first year that this dinner started, really, that I would sponsor these scholarships. And I hope one day that I don't have to sponsor these scholarships, because that means that we're not thinking of diversity as something different, that it's just normal course of action. And the only way to change that is to raise our children to not think of it any differently. And if you read the essay, that is the winning essay that is in your brochure, you will see some wonderful insights from a young woman who grew up in Garden City and learned that across the street in Hempstead was a very different place, but it shouldn't be. And her essay is fantastic and wonderful, wonderful insights, as were the other two. They're just not printed in your brochure. And I also think it's very interesting that the night after a university president is stepping down because the students said they had enough, that we're here with Hofstra doing something right and celebrating what's right about our world and not what's wrong about our world. So I thank you, Stuart, and I thank you, Larry. And last, because I stand between you and more awards, I always try to give a shameless plug to Larry, Bob, and Chris, because their work is fantastic, and I am one of the financial institutions that has been privileged to hire them to do some market research data for us, and it is phenomenal. If you walk around Bethpage and we're at a board meeting or a strategic planning meeting, somebody always says, well, what does the Hofstra study say? What's that big book say? And oftentimes people say, does anybody have the Hofstra study? I need to look some numbers up. And it's something that has become a tool for us. And I can't thank them enough for the diligent work, and it lives on, and it's become like a presence at the credit union. So thank you, and have a wonderful evening, and thank you for having me.
And yes, more awards. Now, many of you have asked us where we got the beautiful image that has become the iconic symbol of the celebration of suburban diversity. It's been on our invitations, it's on our journals, it's everywhere we can paste it up. Well, it comes from a man who has made his mark both as an internist in medicine and artist. A man who this year was kind and generous enough to donate the original work of art that the posters are based on to Hofstra. And I think that he finally now deserves to be recognized in the flesh. Milt Mazur. Milt, there you are. Milt just retired from medicine after 48 or 47 years of practice.
Thanks very much. I think that the goals of this organization are wonderful, and I'm glad I played a little role in furthering it. Thank you.
And now it's my pleasure to introduce Hofstra's new provost and senior vice president for academic affairs. In fact, in the spirit of this occasion celebrating diversity, the first woman to hold this critical position at Hofstra, Dr. Gail Simmons.
Good evening. It really is an honor and a privilege to be here, both as part of this event and as part of Hofstra University. And I'm deeply grateful to President Rabinowitz for giving me this opportunity to be here. It's kind of tough to be the final presenter before dinner, because I know you're all hungry. But Larry did ask me if, since I'm new to the organization, if I would talk just a little bit about my own diversity journey. I will tell you he did not tell me I had a 2.5 minute limit, but I'm gonna try to keep to that anyhow. Yeah, I'm his boss. So I don't, standing here, look too much like a poster child for diversity, but it has been an interesting journey. As Larry points out, I am the first woman to hold this position, and I have, in many of the administrative positions in academia that I've held, been the first woman in those positions. It's also interesting being a woman who is a scientist, because that was not a path that was planned for me. I had a father and mother who were wonderful, and in fact were both veterans. I've been thinking about them a lot today. But my father in particular was not convinced that college was even something for girls, let alone a career in genetics, in academia. So I had to rely, when I went off to college, on other kinds of support. And there were wonderful faculty at the University of Pittsburgh, where I studied, who said, no, you can do this. You may not look like us, because we are all men, but you can do this, and we will support you. We will let you in on the secrets of how you apply to graduate school, and how you get a fellowship, and how you go onward. They didn't look like me, but they knew that it was important that people like me become scientists. And I think that's because they knew that if only one kind of person does science, there's a whole lot of science that's not getting done. If you are not educating and training everybody who wants to be a scientist to be one, then there are whole millions of scientific questions that are not being asked and that no one is trying to answer. You see this play out very explicitly when you look at what's happened to the way that organizations like the National Institutes of Health fund research. 50 years ago, every research study funded by the NIH had as its target population healthy white men between the ages of 20 and 40. Now, that is not the case, and that's because there are people doing those studies who are not healthy white men between the ages of 20 and 40. They are black, they are Hispanic, they are women, they are people of other colors, other religions, other races, other sexual orientations. And that has changed the game for how we think about health. Every field has to experience that. The other piece of my journey in dealing with diversity, in confronting diversity and being changed by diversity, actually came when I became a faculty member at City College of New York, which is the flagship campus of CUNY, which is up in Harlem. And when I first came to City College, I had very little experience teaching, and I was assigned to teach a class in my discipline, genetics. And I walked into the classroom on the very first day and realized that I was the only Anglo in the room. And my first thought was, oh my God, I have no idea what to do. And my second thought is there's no one here like me. And I think it took about 3 weeks into the semester to realize that that was not true. That they were all like me in their interest in studying science. A lot of them were an awful lot like my father because they were the first people in their families to go to college. And after that semester, it became my version of tikkun olam to say that wherever I went and wherever I worked in academia, my job was to lift up the people who don't look like me, but who need to be here. And so I'm very proud to be in an institution like Hofstra that has that as part of its mission, part of its DNA, if you will, and is so eager and so expansive in its embrace of diversity. And I hope I am equal to the task of being part of this great organization. So without further ado, was that 2.5 minutes? Was that good? Okay, cool. So without further ado, it is my great pleasure to introduce 4 awardees at this evening's diversity dinner. You can read extensive biographies of our awardees in the program, so I will be more brief, but no less sincere in welcoming these 4 individuals up to the dais. Our first awardee is Sandy Brewster Walker. Sandy is chair of the Board of Trustees and acting executive director of the Long Island Indigenous People Museum and Research Institute, which was just granted a provisional charter by the state in 2014. Sandy has been an advocate for recovering and celebrating the history of Native and Black Americans in venues that range from the high school history classroom to the halls of the Clinton administration. She is an independent historian, genealogist, freelance writer, and business owner born in the old Copiog Lakeside Hospital and raised in North Amityville. She is the author of Colored Girl from Long Island and the soon-to-be-released book on Long Island, Black and Native Americans in World War I, a 4-volume series, Sandy Brewster Walker.
Thank you. And you're going to have to bear with me. I'm a little visually impaired. I was going to thank Larry. But anyway, I accept this honor for all of the indigenous people of Long Island, and you saw some of them here. We want you to take, I can't really see this. Sorry, I can't really see that. We want you to take the time and learn about our history, our culture, and our heritage. Today, we, the indigenous people, we are the invisible people of Long Island, but we live and we work side by side you. When Long Islanders think of Indians, most of them think of Tonto, or the Indian, a TV Indian, or the Indians west of the Mississippi River. But we never looked like a Tonto. We were people of all shades of brown. In fact, in 1524, when Giovanni Verrazano discovered Long Island, the Island of Shells, he mentioned that we were of all different sizes and that we were of all different colors. When we're not in regalia like you saw earlier tonight, people don't recognize us. We have all been taught, too, by our ancestors, our family connections. We've all been taught the history and the heritage of Long Island. Our ancestors have been involved in the American Revolution. We also fought in all the other wars. Most people don't know that the first person of color in the 1800s from New York State had parents that were both Shinnecock and Montaukett. We also had veterans in the Civil War and the U.S. colored troops. In fact, one of them actually desegregated the Amityville school system in the 1800s. We were whalers. Our ancestors worked for Lloyd over at the estate. We worked on the Floyd estate. We worked at William Smith's estate. We worked at the Longwood estate. We also worked for Senator Robert Kennedy on the North Shore. We worked for the first person that started Republic Aviation. We also worked for Al Capone. In fact, one of my relatives cooked for Al Capone during Prohibition. When George Washington toured the island after the American Revolution, he sat in a chair that was done by a Native American from Amityville. I just wanted to say that when you tour the different historical sites on Long Island, ask them who were the cooks, the gardeners, the farmhands, who raised their children. It was the indigenous people of Long Island. As John Strong said, and as you witnessed tonight, we are still here. Thank you.
Our next honoree is Gemma De Leon Lopresti, International Vice President, United Food and Commercial Workers Union, and President, Local 1102 RWDSU UCFW. President of Local 1102, Gemma De Leon Lopresti is a native of the Philippines who emigrated to Queens at age 5. A BA and MBA graduate of St. John's, she is an officer of multiple union organizations and president of the local. Beyond her union work, she serves on numerous boards for organizations that work to improve the lives of the most vulnerable Long Islanders and to solve the most pressing problems of our community. Gemma De Leon Lopresti.
Thank you very much. I hope everybody's having a good evening, and I'm so privileged to be sharing this award with so many distinguished honorees. Thank you, Larry Levy, for your persistence. Thank you, Stuart Binowitz, for your vision. And thank you, Gail, for this incredible honor and for the kind words. I also want to call everybody's attention to the important work that Hofstra University's Center for Suburban Studies does in valuing the contribution that immigrants and people of color play in the economic fabric of our society as well as our politics, and in turn that affects public policy. So it's extremely crucial work, and I thank you for that work. I'm honored to accept this award on behalf of the members of the Retail, Wholesale, and Department Store Union, Local 1102, which is part of the 1.4 million members of the United Food and Commercial Union, Commercial Workers Union. And I'd like to ask the members of my union to please stand up and be recognized. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no better example of where diversity works best than at a union workplace. Like me and my parents, who immigrated here from the Philippines, members of my union came here from all across the globe, not because they wanted to climb the corporate ladder, but because they dreamt of a better life for their children and for their grandchildren. Our members' jobs are equally diverse. They prepare meals for kids in school districts across the island. We clean and maintain the grounds and buildings at Hofstra University. And we also prepare all of the food that's served in all of its cafeterias. We sell baseball bats at Modell Sporting Goods. We sell those shoes at Saks Fifth Avenue. And we also ring up those dresses at H&M. And we package food and drive it to your plane at JFK and Newark airports. And while you're waiting for your flight at LaGuardia, we sold you perfume at international and duty-free shops. We even made sandwiches at Starbucks when you bought that coffee. So unions are an integral part of the diverse communities in which we live and work. And what we do positively affects each and every person in this room, from getting your spouse's medical bills taken care of to getting that much-needed pension check so you can catch that early bird special when you go to the restaurant, from getting a paid sick day so you can take your child to the doctor, or signing up for a course on how to drive a forklift, or creating a culinary masterpiece, to learning how to speak English, putting yourself through college, becoming a US citizen, and voting for the very first time. This is what unions do for our communities and for the workers that we represent. Across the globe, countries and companies with policies that support strong unions have a thriving middle class and higher standards of living. Thank you, Hofstra University, for this honor and for sharing our values and the belief that the way to building a stronger middle class is and a sustainable economy is with good jobs, with great opportunities, healthcare and benefits, and a dignified retirement. That's what economic diversity is all about. Thank you very much.
Our next honoree is Raj Mehta, Chairman and CEO of Infosys International Incorporated. Raj Mehta is a native of Gujarat State in India who arrived in Washington, D.C. and found his way to a job with Sperry Corporation, working on projects with impacts that are literally out of this world, including the space shuttle. In 1986, he launched Infosys International, a business and information technology consulting firm. At the same time, his numerous nonprofit activities, as well as his ITV Gold talk show, have demonstrated his dedication to improving the Long Island community for everyone. He was the first Indian American to win one of Networking Magazine's prestigious 2008 David Awards and was voted Businessman of the Year in 2013. Raj Mehta.
Good evening. First, I want to wish happy Veterans Day to all of you. And I want to thank to all the veterans and the families of veterans for providing us the blanket of freedom under which we sleep and rise in the morning. So thank you. And I am going to thank all of the veterans and family by Indian tradition as bowing down my head. The second is that I want to actually thank Larry Levy, Ina Katz, and the entire Hofstra team for doing this wonderful job and giving me this honor. So please give a big hand to Larry and Ina and everybody here. And the third thing is, today is really auspicious day in Indian calendar. It's called Diwali. I'm not sure how many people know about Diwali, but first I want to wish you happy Diwali. And then I'm going to tell you about a little bit about Diwali. Diwali is a festival of lights that is being celebrated every year by approximately 800 million Indians worldwide. It's one of the largest celebrated festivals in the country. It comprises of 4 days. The day one, when we do worship the goddess of wealth, we also do like a special drawings on our foyer to welcome the goddess of wealth. The second day is celebrated by getting out from our home all the fights and quarrels and disagreement from our home. And the third day is the Diwali day, which is today, where we celebrate meeting friends and family, and we do firecrackers. We also put the diya, which is a light, you know, all over our house. We light our house. And also people who are in business, they open their new books because the next day is the New Year day. So we close our books and open new books tomorrow. And the last day, which is tomorrow, is the New Year day. So I want to also wish all of you Happy New Year tomorrow. And the significance of New Year day. Significance of New Year is that every business person who is in business, that everybody else wants to give them the first order for a good omen for the whole year. So I'll be open tomorrow at 9 o'clock. If anyone wants to give me a contract, I'll be ready to do that. And the second and the last thing that I want to say before, that I want to tell you a little bit about my story, that I, you know, most of the thing has already been said here, but I came in 1978 with $6 in my pocket and a dream. $6 in my pocket, and I started my company. I started, you know, first I started part-time study, full-time work, and then full-time study, part-time work, and started working for a small minority-owned firm in Washington, D.C., and then subsequently went to Sperry, working for Sperry, and I came here in Long Island in 1982 as a consultant to Grumman Data Systems. After that, in 1986, I started the company for one of my bedroom in Comac. Then we moved into 6080 Jericho Turnpike in Comac, 500 square feet office, little bit, and after a few years, we expanded over there. Moved again into 535 Broad Hollow Road in Melville. Again, same thing, after a few years expanded. And now I'm a proud owner of 14,000 square feet building in Plainview, where we headquarter our office. We became the fastest growing company. And I must say, I must recognize Raz Goldmacher, who is here. She's the one who financed our building. So Raz, thank you very much. We became the fastest growing company in Long Island 2 years in a row. And we became twice Inc. 500 company. So that is, it's kind of very proud for me to come and park my car over there, whatever car I have. So again, you know, I want to thank Hofstra University. I want to thank Larry for giving me this honor. And I also want to congratulate the other honorees right here. And thank you very much. And good night, everybody.
And our final honoree this evening is Mandel Smith, field manager of Northwestern Mutual. Mandel Smith is an entrepreneur with more than 10 years' experience in developing, leading, and managing small business ventures. Most recently, he owned and operated a State Farm insurance agency on Long Island. He is noted in his work for his personal touch with clients, going the extra mile to help them understand their needs. Recognizing the importance of good role models in his own life, Mandel proudly shares his experience as a young entrepreneur with both high school and college students. He is a passionate mentor who brings a disciplined approach to people development. Mandel was recently selected as an honorary co-chair of the Haitian Roundtable in New York City. Mandel Smith.
Wow. Oh my goodness. You guys look great out there. All right, it's a tough act to follow, Raj. Love the energy. Before I get started, I'd just like to take a moment and just highlight all the veterans, any family members of veterans, who take a second to maybe bow our heads. Thank you. First and foremost, I'd like to thank Hofstra University, Executive Dean Larry Levy, my good friend who's here, Mr. Phil Solages, my Northwestern Mutual family, and most importantly, my wife and loved ones are all attending here tonight. I'm thankful to be recognized for my continued efforts within the community, especially as it relates to diversity on Long Island. At Northwestern Mutual, we help families achieve financial security through a comprehensive planning process that incorporates risk management, wealth accumulation, and preservation strategies that are tailored to fit each individual. My passion as a financial planner is to help individuals and organizations reach their truest potential, whether it be personally, professionally, or financially. Over the last several years, I've worked closely with the Haitian Roundtable, a New York City-based non-for-profit organization. Ms. Rose Pierre-Louis, founding member and senior advisor to the mayor of New York City, is joining us here as my guest this evening. Her mission was to create a social footprint that recognizes Haitian American professionals whose efforts are to drive civic engagement and philanthropic efforts that benefit Haiti and Haitian organizations. After the devastating earthquake, we worked together to raise over $300,000 to benefit relief efforts. So I appreciate the opportunity to be involved with Rose and the members of HRT in helping making a small impact on the lives to those who were affected by the earthquake. Hofstra University's Center for Suburban Studies creates a platform for open discussion around diversity and diversity-related issues. They have taken the lead in educating their students on diversity and social responsibility for all members in the community. It is important for us to exercise our social responsibility and influence our communities to drive sustainable diversity for generations to come. Thank you.
You know, what made Mandel's work with the Haitian Roundtable and Haitian Relief so special is that he's not Haitian. And that's really the spirit of what this event is about, people reaching across communities, giving when there's no obvious blood reason to do it. And now, dinner. Thank you for being so patient, and please enjoy. By the way, if you are not going to stay for dinner, please let your waiter know so that we can donate the meal to the Interfaith Nutrition Network. If the meal is served, we cannot donate it. So just let your waiter, waitress know whether you're going to be staying. Thank you.